My wife always jokes that the thing I am worst at in all the world is leisure. I just can't do it. As an engineer, I just look at the built world and I'm constantly finding things and I'm like, oh, someone really thought about this, or the opposite. And as much as that is a gift, it is also a curse. This is what you do when it's late at night and you need your eyes open for another another couple hours to get that board out. This guy, right? Super cheap. This is a, you know, just a little whisk for your coffee. How can they get something that's cheaply made spinning at that RPM and not oscillating? And something about the design inherently is more stable, and I'm curious what that is, and I don't know. I've been an educator, I've been a consultant, I've been an engineer, I've built solar energy things, like I've done a lot of different things. But I had this like anxiety, which took me kind of years to recognize. As someone that had been kind of involved in the maker movement and would go to Maker Faire and all that stuff, I loved that the maker scene was coming to be, but then when you actually go in, it's like, oh God, this person's like never used a tool. I'm seeing that more and more, and I'm starting to get terrified, like, oh no, like as this scene develops, is something gonna happen? I remember hearing about this incident at Yale a number of years ago.
Her name was Michelle Dufault, and she died a month short of graduation from Yale. From what authorities have revealed, she was working in the machine shop of Sterling Chemical Laboratory in the middle of the night when her hair got caught in a lathe.
What's interesting is I heard that and I assumed it was some huge industrial machine. I learned that from what I can gather, right, we only know what's reported, that it was actually a relatively small lathe. We've read a lot of OSHA incident reports, right? The ones that break my heart the most is when the employee does everything they're supposed to do and they still get injured or die. One thing that we've seen a lot of is there'll be a large industrial machine. Someone gets caught, right? And it's a very slow moving machine. And so they go and they press the emergency stop button that's right where it should be, and they press it. But that machine has inertia, and over a minute sucks them in and still kills them. And those, for me, it's like, that's just an engineering failure. Someone tried to do a safety thing, someone was responding in a good way, it's just, they missed the mark. I started looking at ways to make machines safer, just in my free time, and I started tinkering. Wrench or something, we can pull off this nut so we can open this door. That's so super standard, and you can just pop the cable band at the time. I was poking around, and I remember specifically sitting in bed on my phone playing, and I found like an old patent for DC injection, right? And it is basically a way to take an AC motor, like a stationary motor that's on any machine, and make it resist rotation. And that was super interesting to me. I'd always assumed at that time that like, oh, industry's got this figured out. Like, I'm just doing this for schools and makerspaces who can't afford stuff. You can go into a $1 billion company's shop and it's worse than makerspaces I've been in.
We're putting a foot switch on this one so people can have free hands. This one will get a break. We're doing the new little jigsaw bandsaw thing. And then also the big Laguna.
I'm Scott. I founded MakeSAFE Tools. Your shop was one of the first places we put one of our early prototypes back in 2018, I think. And so since then, whenever we can, we've been donating equipment. You've probably seen on the bandsaws, they all have our brakes. And so we will be adding a few more today.
Of reported injuries, okay, just injuries that are reported, which is a small fraction, and that result in people missing days from work, right? And could have been directly prevented by this, right? We only have a couple features. So you filter all those out and it's about 40,000 a year. And the scariest part of that is roughly a flat line over the last 15 years. It's not getting better each year, it just hovers.
And is you know this machine normally tells about 40 seconds, 30 seconds. Now every time you turn it off, it'll just stop.
Wow.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
It should be our responsibility, and OSHA says it is for employers, that any known hazard you have to mitigate.
You ever heard of a Giglio valve? You know what that is? Neither did I. But my wife loves fancy coffee. And this little valve on here, you know, if you press it, you can smell your lovely coffee smell come out. But it's a one-way valve for air so your coffee can breathe, but somehow doesn't let certain complex organics out. So like the coffee doesn't dry out. Don't know how it works. Spend a little time looking at their patents. But yeah, that's like, I just lost an evening, right? Looking up what that is and like how that works. I got catalogs. That's our last thing going in. We'll strap it down and then cross our fingers and hope it's all still there when we get to San Antonio. Very early on in my journey, I realized that this was a much bigger problem than just schools. And so we wanted to reach the larger market, right? We wanted to reach industry. And over time found that since our project is a little bit of a niche, it's something that didn't really exist in this form before, so it's not anything someone's gonna look for. And the only way to sell our product was to show people.
Here we are, ASSP Safety 2023 in San Antonio, Texas, just about a block from the Alamo, getting ready to head in.
So this is plugged into our product, that one is not. Go ahead and hit the stop button. So the product that we're installed with actually stops. This is safe now, where that has inertia, right? Like any tool, keep going. And that's a whole bunch of hazardous energy that's gonna get someone in trouble.
We're just starting to bridge into the kind of volume game. Now, how do we make 300 of these instead of 100 at a time and maintain quality, right? We are now having to worry about things like version management with different manufacturers. We're worried about supply chain. We're worried about all these different elements that required a larger software, but we don't have the infrastructure to support some huge database thing, right? Altium has worked really well for us as we're transitioning from, you know, a guy to a four-person team that is making a product that is shipping all over the world. We could not have done that with other softwares.
I think that Altium's the base of pretty much everything that is created at MakeSAFE. Using Altium has been the first time that I've ever touched anything relating to PCB design. There's this amazing, easy collaboration with no finicky extra software that you have to deal with.
Altium 365, it's kind of the cloud side of Altium. It's the kind of the way you can look at things in a browser where something as simple as, oh, I'm building a board. I need my reference schematic. Most software, you're digging through file structures. Is it on the server? Is it like, it's this mess. I literally just go to a homepage and it shows my boards and I click on one and there's a list of versions and it has a completely interactive render of the schematic, the PCB in 2D, the PCB in 3D. I can click around, I can cut, like, I don't need to open the software.
This board is something we designed for Altium. It's a standard two-layer, two-ounce copper board. Almost every single day I have Altium open my laptop. I'm double-checking, oh, which connection am I looking at on the board? I'm comparing it with the circuit. And especially the crosstalk between the schematic and the PCB pages where you can like click on a net in the schematic and highlights it in the PCB. That's extremely helpful to me.
We are at a place where one person can actually start a technical company. We have access to materials like you never did before. At first I was like, oh, you know, our thing's so simple. We're doing such like low hanging fruit. I want to do something that's like detecting faults and doing all this fancy engineering. It's like, no. Like, this is the stuff that we know works, that we can like get in, that we know will save people, period. This is the time to, if you want to build something, build it. Stop talking about it, build it. And it's going to be terrible and you're going to get frustrated and you're going to make 100 mistakes and who cares, build it. And the chances are, it will be awesome.
you for watching Altium Stories. If you found this story inspiring, don't forget to hit the like button and share it with your friends and colleagues. By subscribing and hitting the bell icon, you'll never miss out on the latest engineering stories from our channel. We would love to hear your thoughts, so please comment and let us know your favorite engineering story. Thank you for supporting us and helping us continue to share the impactful work being done by engineers around the world.